In today's episode, we install the cylinder heads onto the engine, lock out the cam phasers, degree the camshafts, and get it back out to Dwayne at Logan Motorsports for a tune and some dyno runs to see what this combination puts down. With the valve job and the head porting complete, the last thing to do was to flatten the cylinder heads. To do this, I glued some 220 and 180 grit sandpaper to a couple sheets of glass, laid them on a very thick granite block, and just gently pulled them back and forth, allowing the weight of the cylinder head to do the work. When checking the flatness of the head, I did use a 1000th feeler gauge in conjunction with that straight edge, as well as had a dial indicator set up to keep track of how much material I was removing. As with the mains, I did end up going with the OEM style torque to yield bolts for the heads as well. To install these, just apply a bit of 30 weight oil to the threads as well as the underside of the head of the bolt and follow the directions in the slides here for torque sequence and values. Obviously, if you are not using factory style torque to yield bolts, then you would want to disregard this and follow the recommendations from the manufacturer of the bolts or studs that you're using. The next thing to do was install the cam phaser lockouts from Livernois Motorsports. Pay special attention to the bolt that holds the end of the spring in place, as well as the bolt that rests underneath the spring. Loosen the bolt that holds the end of the spring in place and remove the other four completely. Swing the backplate out of the way, making sure that the small coil spring and plunger do not shoot out, and find the spot where the cam phaser lockout fits most snug. Reinstall the small spring and plunger, backplate, and all of the bolts with blue Loctite. And don't forget to install the final bolt underneath the spring by simply prying the spring up out of the way with a flat screwdriver. The next order of business is timing or degreeing the camshafts, which is the process of setting the camshaft center line to a specific number of degrees of crankshaft rotation. And for these camshafts, our cam card tells us we're looking for the intake center line to be at 102 degrees. If any adjustments to camshaft timing are needed, you'll need adjustable sprockets either on the camshaft side or on the crankshaft side, such as these ones from TrickFlow, which allow you to adjust the camshaft timing in 2-degree increments by use of multiple keyways. Install all of your timing components as normal and line up the timing marks. Choose the appropriate washers and spacers to install the degree wheel on the end of your crankshaft. And now we'll find true top dead center by use of a piston stop. But before I install the piston stop, I always install a clean, long screwdriver in the bore and rotate the crank until I know the piston is far enough down the bore that it's completely out of the way. With the piston stop installed, slowly and gently rotate the crankshaft until you feel the crown of the piston run into the piston stop. When you hit the piston stop, set your degree wheel to zero, and now rotate the crankshaft back in the other direction. When you hit the piston stop going the other direction, note the number of degrees on the degree wheel, which in this case is 98. Divide that number by 2, and we would get 49 degrees. So we can advance the degree wheel to 49, snug down the bolt, and now rotate the crankshaft back in the other direction. If we come up with 49 degrees before top dead center going clockwise again, we know that our true top dead center is at 0 degrees on the degree wheel. Okay, so I need to back up and cover something that I actually forgot to cover when I was filming this in the shop while putting the engine together and degreeing the cams, and that is, if you have hydraulic lifters in your engine and you can't So maybe if you have a pushrod engine and you can go directly off the body of the lifter, that would be an option. Otherwise, if you are running hydraulic lifters or lash adjusters, as these are called, what they have is a spring and a plunger inside them, and with the aid of oil pressure, essentially takes up the lash while your engine is running. So no need to ever adjust lash. Oil pressure will do that for you. When you're degreeing the cams and the engine is not running, what you can run into is that the pressure of trying to open the valve against the spring pressure can actually cause this to bleed down because there is no oil pressure being fed to it because the engine is not running. This will bleed down, and this can compress while you are trying to degree the cams, and it can give you false readings. And so when you're degreeing a cam, it has to be at a zero lash. So even if you were going to use a solid lifter cam, you would have to adjust it either through the push rods or the rockers, whatever. You'd have to adjust all of the lash out of it. We'll cover exactly what zero lash means in a minute, but the way that you do that with a hydraulic lifter is that you have to bleed all of the oil. You can see a little bit of oil is coming out of this one, especially if they're used old lifters or lash adjusters. Through brake clean, a vise to clamp this thing, compressed air, etc., etc., spend a lot of time getting this thing cleaned out so that it moves freely in and out like this. Right, you can't have any residual oil or anything left in there that's going to give you a false reading when you actually go to degree the cams. Once we've got a lifter or a lash adjuster completely cleaned out, squeaky clean, moves in and out without any resistance at all, and it hits solidly when it collapses, so we're going to install that into the head, follower on top of it across from an installed valve. Obviously, if you were putting this on the engine, all the valves would be installed, or if it was already on the engine, all of the valves would be installed. Install a camshaft. You want the follower riding on the base circle of the camshaft, so not anywhere up here in the lobe or in the ramps up to the lobe, where it's going to start to close that gap for you and start to collapse the lifter. It's got to be on the base circle of the camshaft. And so we're just going to take some feeler gauges and collapse that lifter and try to figure out how much space, how much lash we have in between. So just press down and kind of wiggle back and forth. And 13 is pretty loose. 14 is a go. Yeah, 15. Okay, so we're going to call that 15. And now we're going to remove the camshaft. And so it's pretty much exactly the same thing as setting up the lash on these when you're assembling the cylinder heads. I've got these shim washers that I got from McMaster Car. They're stainless steel 14 millimeter OD washers, and I got them in 0.2 and 0.3 millimeter thicknesses, so it's about 8 and 12 thousandths. And we're just going to try and come up with a combination of these washers that equals not our lash but two times our lash, because these are about a 2-to-1 rocker. So if I was at 15, I'm going to need about 30. So let's say 2 eighths and a 12, see where that gets us. So about 28 and a half. If I did 2 12s and an 8, I'd be way too big. So 28 and a half is going to give us about 1 thou of lash still, but let's just put it in there anyways and see how it feels. If it's so little that we cannot measure it with a feeler gauge, then I would say that's good enough for me. And we'll just press this down, see how that feels. So we do have a tiny bit of compression still in the lash adjuster. Okay, so I've got the caps on. And I've got the smallest feeler gauge that I have, which is a 1.5 thousandths. And let's just see if I can get that in there. And I cannot. So I'm going to say that that is zero lash. And from here, we are ready to start degreeing our camshaft. So now we can remove the piston stop and install the dial indicator on one of the intake valves for that cylinder. An important thing to note here is that at top dead center, or at 0 degrees on the degree wheel, you should be at the beginning of the intake stroke. As you rotate your crankshaft clockwise, the intake valve should begin to open. Rotate until the intake valve reaches max lift and zero out your dial gauge. Now rotate the engine backwards until the dial indicator reads about 0.01 thousandths before max lift. Rotate the engine back forward until you get to 0.50 thousandths. This is your first reading. In this case, we have 67 degrees. And now we'll rotate the crankshaft clockwise once more to go past max lift and back down to 0.50 thousandths. This is our second reading. And here we have 136 degrees. So now we found that 0.50 thousandths before max lift is at 67 degrees, and 0.50 thousandths after max lift is 136 degrees. So if we add those together and divide by 2, we get our true camshaft load centerline at 101.5 degrees. Since our crank sprockets are only adjustable in 2-degree increments, we are going to have to live with that 0.5 degree variance. But I should also note that this is with the sprockets set in the A2 setting, or advanced 2 degrees. With the sprockets in the 0 position, I was at 103.5 and 103.75 respectively. For these two-piece adjustable sprockets, it is recommended that once you have your positioning set, you tack weld them together to keep from shearing the keyway off under use. As a single piece or tack together, they are able to spread the load across more of the keyway. The welded sprocket is now reinstalled onto the crankshaft with the A2 mark over the keyway, and the A2 mark on the tooth of the sprocket is now our new timing mark to line up with the dark link of the timing chain. Install the rest of the timing components as usual, lining up the dark links on the timing chain with the correct marks on each camshaft sprocket. So right here, we're going to jump straight ahead to getting this thing on the dyno, and I'm not going to cover any of the additional assembly or dressing or getting the engine into the car in this video. And there you have it, guys. The 3-valve is complete. It's in the car and it's putting down 350 foot-pounds of torque and 352 rear wheel horsepower. I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. If you found it useful, please feel free to give me a like, hit that subscribe button, and come find me on Instagram. I am at Bradford's Garage over there as well. We will catch you guys on the next one. Thanks.